This is Rob Gray from ASU and PerceptionAction.com. Today on the Perception in Action podcast, my interview with Sean Eagle from the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center Concussion Program, taking an ecological approach to understanding and testing for sports-related concussions. So it's time for a call to action. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Perception in Action podcast, where I discuss how psychological research can be applied to improving performance, accelerating skill acquisition, and designing technologies. In today's episode, my interview with Sean Eagle. Sean received his PhD from the University of Pittsburgh working with Chris Conaboy. He is now working as a postdoc in Pittsburgh Medical Center's concussion program. As you will hear, Sean and colleagues have been doing some really interesting work looking at how sports-related concussions affect an athlete's perception-action coupling and affordance perception. Hope you enjoy.
Not 10 years ago, I was a child. I was a good boy and you let me go. Now I'm on a talk show.
Okay, today my guest is Sean Eagle from the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. Thanks for joining me, Sean.
Thanks for having me.
To start off, can you tell us a little bit about your background? And one of the, you know, the main thing we're going to talk about today is studying concussions. So a little bit about how you got interested in that.
Sure. Yeah. So I just finished my PhD at the University of Pittsburgh. And prior to that, you know, I was a college athlete. I had several personal concussions, and I was clinically trained as an athletic trainer. So concussions and their consequences were always a part of my life. And when I started my doctoral work in 2015, studies started pouring in the peer-reviewed literature, showing an increased risk for musculoskeletal injury after you've had a concussion in athletes. And that phenomenon really piqued my interest. Other authors were kind of postulating that maybe impaired postural stability or balance or dual task test impairments may be related to this risk. But I had a hard time rationalizing that with myself. And I wasn't really aware of this ecological approach and the direct perception theories. At the time, I was kind of talking to one of my advisors, Dr. Chris Conaboy, who's also at the University of Pittsburgh. And I was talking out loud, like, how could something like balance, which resolves in 3 to 5 days post-concussion, be related to this injury risk? And he kind of smiled and pointed me in this direction of Gibson's direct perception theory. And we went from there.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Also, I had a brief concussion experience too. It's funny how our careers kind of out of our necessity or something related to our own sporting careers. I find that's very common. And yes, so you mentioned, yeah, your approach, yours and Chris's approach to studying concussions is quite a bit different from the kind of traditional way. You know, you have this perception action coupling model of concussion. So can you talk a little bit about what that is and how it differs from the more traditional kind of indirect approaches?
Yeah, so our model is quite different from the way people have looked at this in the past in the concussion field. We just published a current opinion piece in Sports Medicine. It just came out this month, January 2020, if you want more information. But the key difference is something you talk about a lot on this show, the perception of stimuli during action. And we really believe that it's a direct perception model stemming from J.J. Gibson's work. And in the past, more indirect approaches have kind of been pervasive in the concussion literature. And they have hypothesized that this divided attention paradigm during activity, when there's an increased cognitive load, such as you would get during sport, following concussion leads to this increased injury risk. And our contention with this hypothesis is that it implies that there's a motor executive in the nervous system perceiving information, planning, using prior experience, and then developing and executing a motor plan. And we just contend that couldn't be possible given time constraints during activity. So in our model, we contend that opportunities for action are directly perceived from the environment. And it is instead the calibration and attunement processes that get dysregulated following concussion. And without adequate time for rehabilitation and deliberate practice, increased musculoskeletal injury risk could occur.
The older view, I guess, was that concussion was kind of a generalized effect, right? It was drawing your attention away from performance, kind of this divided attention overload performance. Whereas I think you're arguing it can be much more specific to specific sports skills and specific abilities by disrupting kind of the coupling and the use of the specific information. Is that a kind of a right way to put it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I wouldn't even call it an older view. It's definitely very common now still. A very similar paper. They don't refer to it as indirect perception, but it came out in Sports Medicine in 2018, right before I started my dissertation work. So the timing was great to kind of have this debate in the literature, but definitely we feel like it's much more specific and it stems from an integration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center's concussion program treatment model, and that there are specific things that happen after you have a concussion. It's not generalized, as you said. And all of these things have been related to a dysregulated perception-action coupling in motor control literature. So we're just trying to integrate those two things together.
That's really interesting. And I guess, one of the big implications from your idea is how we test and assess, the effects of concussion and when you're, ready to return to play. The traditional way, and I guess as you say, it's still being done, is to test that very generally with like cognitive tests on pieces on paper and, simple spatial tests. And I'm assuming that in your model, those would really tell you nothing, right? Because they're not, they're out of context, the information's not there. So we need much more specific tests, correct?
Right. Yeah. The return to play issue is still a major issue in sport related concussion. More and more we've shown, not we personally, but other investigators have shown, nervous system impairments that are undetectable by clinical measures. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to get more into the space of how can we detect these things and contribute to the concussion assessment battery that's already out there.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I guess, I might dig in a bit deeper. I don't know how far along with you are with this idea to understand exactly what gets disrupted in after a concussion. Is it, not picking up the information or using the wrong different information to control your action? So do you more specifically in terms of the perception action coupling, do you know what happens after a concussion?
Sure. Yeah. So there's the paper I'm referencing is definitely a 10,000 foot view of the issue. It's just kind of getting the concept out there and suggesting ideas. So we have some study ideas that we're getting ready to initiate, looking at, we think it could be either calibration or attunement issues or both.
Okay.
And we've kind of taken those ideas from studies such as the stuff that has come out from Kathy Craig in the past, using virtual reality, looking at differences in highly skilled rugby players and football players compared to novice football players and their attunement processes. And we're going to kind of extrapolate that into the injury risk world and try to get a deeper understanding of what specifically is happening.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I wonder if you could relate it, I'm just thinking off the top of my head here. So to some of the stuff that myself and other people have done in choking, kind of Richard Masters ideas, that maybe after concussion it's almost like a regression to an earlier stage where you're using different information, different coupling, because you're kind of worried about and more, thinking about what you're doing, like we tend to see with choking. I don't know if that idea has any merit or not. What do you think?
It absolutely does. It's another option that we proposed in that paper, in that, most people, not most, 90% of people recover spontaneously from a concussion. There are others, however, that have long-lasting issues, and many don't even know that there are issues, changes in ocular function, anxiety or mood, vestibular dysfunction, So it could be that those, the variables that you had tuned into for performance in the past have fundamentally changed. Mm-hmm. The perception of them has changed, and they may be changed for a long time. And so you need to attune to this new level of dynamics that are in your environment.
Yeah, I think that's a really good way of thinking about it. And a few, maybe last year sometime, I did a presentation where, you know, I was trying to argue that we need to get rid of the rephrase recovery from injury, because, you know, the idea that you can go back to where you were before is kind of a myth, right? You need to, I like the idea of adapting to injury, right? You have a new situation you're, you know, in front of, you have to find a new, you know, perception action solution, just like you've always done as you develop the skills. So thinking about it as going back, I think, is sometimes counterproductive.
Yeah, absolutely. I think adaptation is the way to put it.
And so another kind of specific thing I've seen you talk about, and as a way, kind of a new way to assess it and as a marker for concussion, is this idea of action boundaries. Can you talk a little bit about what those are and how you've been using them?
Yeah, so our definition of action boundary stems from Gibson's, and it's pretty simple. It's just the limit of your individual ability to perform a given action. And, you know, you can think of them as the inverse of action capabilities, which have been thought of as the combination of the body's proportions with your internal biodynamics that make a given task possible. And Dr. Conaboy developed a test battery for this action boundary behavior, and we used it in some studies applying to concussion and differences to kind of investigate this injury risk issue. One of the main ones is called the perception action coupling task, or we just call it PACT. It's a 15-minute test that's conducted on an iPad, and we've used it for many studies so far. It's very simple. Testers have to move between a home button and a joystick on the iPad to determine if a virtual ball fits into a virtual hole at the top of the screen. And these ball-hole pairings are pseudo-randomized for time intervals and size ratios. And PACT measures a host of different variables, including reaction time, movement time between the joystick and the home button, and overall response time, as well as accuracy. And did you correctly perceive the affordance or not? And we're most interested in the outcomes when that ball only narrowly fits within the hole and vice versa, as this measure, we expect, reflects the behavior closest around the action boundary, if that makes sense.
Mm, definitely. And so do you find a kind of a systematic effect of concussion on those judgments?
Yeah, so our first study together, we published it in the Clinical Journal of Sports Medicine in March of 2019, and we reported deficits in affordance perception accuracy and actualization in college-aged athletes with a concussion history. And what was super interesting about that is this occurred despite the fact that average time since injury was 264 days. Wow. Since their recent injury. Mm-hmm. So that was very compelling for us, because this is something that you can't tell with our clinical measures currently. And so this is a potentially a deficit that's been related to injury risk in other literatures outside of the concussion space. And so we were very interested in that result. And we followed that up with my dissertation work, where we looked at differences between concussed youth athletes in a shorter time frame, much closer to concussion, within 10 days. All of them were children less than 18 years old. And then we compared them to healthy youth athletes. And again, we saw a 5% deficit in overall accuracy in the concussed group. And the largest deficit was observed closest to that action boundary.
Well, that's really interesting. And I guess, you know, two kind of questions that jumped to mind to me about that is, I can't remember from your paper if this, I remember reading it, but is there a specific bias in one direction? Or do people overestimate the ability, the action, the affordance, or underestimate?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the action boundary deficits we've observed are always at the 0.8 ratio. And what that means is that the ball is only slightly smaller than the hole, so it just barely fits. Mm-hmm. Accuracy is extremely high when the ball is slightly larger than the hole.
Okay. So
people are very good at knowing when an affordance isn't there, when they can't do it. So whenever the ball is larger than the hole, the accuracy is extremely high. It gets a little bit variable when the ball is slightly smaller than the hole.
Oh, that's interesting. I guess, you know, kind of intuitively, that sort of makes sense in terms of a concussion. It sounds like they're not being aggressive enough, right, about seeing it as an opportunity when it's really, really tight, which you might expect, you know, when you've had a concussion, you might expect that would be kind of the bias you develop. Is that the correct way of thinking of it?
Yeah, that hesitation factor, I think, is something that we need to look into more, and that may be related to the injury risk question. Are you not confident in your abilities to actualize an affordance after injury? Do you need more time to get used to the dynamics of play?
Yeah, and I guess the fact that you get errors in one direction but not the other, it deals with this question, but I wanted to ask it anyway. You know, can you specifically relate this to affordance perception? For example, can you rule out the possibility that their judgments of size aren't accurate, or their of the ball, or their motion perception somehow impaired? So can you specifically say this is an affordance problem?
Yeah, so two things on that. We did do a reliability and stability investigation with this test, and did find that you do need one practice round before performance stabilizes. So they're definitely used to the tests. And we did kind of extrapolate our work into a more whole body investigation, dynamic investigation, with another doctoral student of Dr. Conaboy's, Dr. Caleb Johnson, who actually just had his dissertation work accepted yesterday in the European Journal of Sports Sciences. So that's coming out soon. But he looked at a maximum broad jump. They recorded that distance. Then the tester changed the testing line to either 100% of the maximum jump distance or slightly less or slightly more while the subject was blinded. And looked at, after the line was set, subjects are instructed to make a rapid decision to the jumpability of that line, quote unquote. So can I get across that line or not based on my own abilities, and respond by either jumping or stepping to the side? And Dr. Johnson found that with fatigue, such as running or wearing a weighted vest, fatigue significantly increased response time, but accuracy was maintained.
Okay. So they could still perceive the affordance of, you know, jumpability or whatever you want to call it accurately.
Yeah. I think in affordance research, we tend to just throw ability on the end.
We do. Yeah.
But yeah, he postulated that accuracy seemed to be most important to the subject. So to compensate an increased response time whenever they were more fatigued, was able to keep that accuracy in check.
Yeah, and I guess that kind of relates to another question I was going to ask you guys. You know, I'm sure this, you know, goes more in the plans for future. I totally understand why you developed the tests the way that you did, but are you thinking about moving it to more where you're perceiving your own affordances? You know, for example, whether you yourself can fit through a gap. I just know that's much harder to do, but is that kind of the direction you're thinking of going eventually?
Absolutely. That's definitely the future of this body of research, I think, and being able to link up with technology's advancements, using virtual reality or augmented reality to try to look at your own individual affordances rather than kind of create this way to look at it in the clinic. We are trying to fill a gap in what is currently available in the clinic to try to do a clinic-friendly test battery that can be used to augment what is currently available. So that was our thought process there.
Yeah, no, I totally understand. I think that's a good way to do it, you know, demonstrate the principle first and then try to do the harder version. I think that would be really interesting, because then you could get into some of these calibration issues. You know, do people accurately calibrate their own speed, their own body size, and maybe there are some distortions of those after concussion?
Sure, yeah.
Oh, that's really interesting. Yeah, I think that's a really, really interesting approach. As you say, the return to play question and how to assess it's still a problem despite years and years of study. And I think this kind of getting more specific and understanding exactly what's wrong is definitely the way to go. Another area that I've seen your group working in a couple of really recent papers is kind of using a similar perception action approach to understanding the relationship between sleep and performance in sports, which we know is hugely, there's a huge effect. Can you talk a little bit about that work?
Sure. Yeah. So the PACT test was initially developed through a grant with NASA, funded by NASA, to look at affordance changes in behavior with sleep deprivation and in isolated confined environments such as experienced by astronauts. And Dr. Conaboy has another doctoral student named Alice LeGoy who has taken this body of research on. And there's a series of papers that have been published in journals like Aerospace Medicine and Human Performance or ACTA Astronautica that have looked at the impairment of action boundary perception when impaired by sleep. And the results are fairly telling and consistent with previous literature that have looked at sleep impairments or sleep disruption and the effect of actualization of affordances.
Yeah, that's really interesting work. Yeah, I know you've shown how it changes the perception of affordances, kind of similar to the concussion work. That's really interesting. I guess the last question I have for you, Sean, and you know you've kind of already touched on the list a little bit, is maybe some of your plans for your future work and where you want to go in this area.
Yeah, so we recently received a small grant from a local organization to further develop and refine the PACT protocol, which we're excited about. And we'd like to do a longitudinal study to investigate, is PACT related to broader injury risk? Is it specifically related to concussion? Are people with impairments in action boundary perception at more risk of without even sustaining an injury? You know, addressing those types of questions. And like I said before, on a broader scale, we're interested in moving into the virtual reality augmented space and looking at, you know, can we assess individual markers of action boundary perception that are calibrated and attuned to the individual themselves.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And I guess, you know, another angle it would be if you develop these measures and things would be a training angle, right? Is there a way we can train people to recalibrate their affordances? But I guess one step at a time, right?
Yeah, absolutely. We think we're just getting started here. There's a lot more work to do, but if we can demonstrate that you know, you are at an increased risk if your action boundary perception is off in sports specifically, can we train that? Can we reduce injury risk by training action boundary perception and doing more sports specific tasks that include that type of behavior?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting approach and definitely will add a lot to this area. So thanks a lot for joining me today, Sean.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks again for the great discussion, Sean. You can find out more about Sean and Chris's work from the links I've posted in the show notes. Remember, you can contact me at robgray@asu.edu or follow me on Twitter at ShakyWeights. To find out more about the podcast, please check out perceptionaction.com. Finally, to support the podcast and receive bonus materials, including written transcripts, please head over to patreon.com/perceptionaction. This is Rob Gray from ASU. Cheers for now, and keep them coupled.